good times in his rhymes, cause his memories. We running through New York, so you never leave. Strap my lungs, then we puffin' through with that, right? We're giving them some stories, they come back like manic this, manic that, why you crawling to me?
Okay guys, welcome back to the channel. So today we're just going to be going over the M47 reliability video of 2019. Now I know a lot of people have this engine and this is the N47. You guys probably know I've already done the B47 engine, but we're going to go over the N47 reliability. Now I'm going to go over the most common cause of problems on this car and also what causes this car to run rough and also what can cause it to run like a bag of crap, let's just put it that way, when they go wrong. And obviously the most common problems on this car, which a lot of people still ain't aware of, and people are still buying this engine and still not aware of the most common problems on this car and what it can lead to. This also goes for the 118D, 120D, 116D. They all run on the M47 engine. The only difference is the power output. So I'm going to be going over to the engine. I'm going to show you all the common problems on this car. So guys, as you'll see here, this is the M47 engine. Now I'm just going to go over the most common problems on this car and show you what can actually go wrong on this car. So as you know, this is a diesel engine. It's M47. It makes 170 brake as standard, I believe. And obviously this is the LCI model, so it'll have more than previous ones. So the first thing I'm going to go over is the crankcase vent valve. Now, this is the updated one, which everyone will probably know. But if you've got the pre-LCI one, they're going to be problematic and you need to change them. When they get clogged, they'll cause oil and cause a lot of black smoke coming out your exhaust. Also blue smoke as well, where oil's been burnt off, where the PCV underneath here, if you was to lift this cap, you just have to replace the PCV inside. It's on a spring and it usually ruptures. And what happens, the diaphragm, and it ruptures and it ends up causing you to leak oil into your manifold and then you to burn oil. This can go bad. And trust me, when it goes bad, it's not a good sign at all. You'll think that your turbo seals are gone or you're burning oil, you're losing oil. That's not the case. Make sure you check this. They're not expensive to replace. They're about £20-25 on eBay or wherever you want to buy them. Even the dealers don't charge much, and that can cure a lot of your symptoms. The next one you're going to notice is that the turbo is on a electronic actuator, same as the B47 engine. You need to be careful of that because they fail as well. They like to cause a rattling sound inside the turbo, so be aware of that as well, because if that does go, it's going to be expensive. The electronic actuators on that is not cheap. They are coming down on price now, but like I say, it's a common failure point, which goes to the turbo, which you'll see right there. You'll see the turbo from the air box, which is right here with the air box pipe, and you also see around here we've got the DPF sensors. We go to the DPF, which register the whole DPF itself and clear it and regenerate it when it needs be, driving on the motorway, when it's not, when it's sitting for too long, when it's idle. So they're another thing you need to be sure of. They are still expensive, them DPF sensors, and they're needed for emissions. I'm a strong believer of not removing the DPF, because that's when you end up having more problems. And because of MOT regulations, it's really not worth it, because obviously if they find out, your car is just going to fail the MOT. So it's worth replacing them, because when they go wrong, they'll cause your DPF not to regenerate and it will clog your DPF up, which will cause your car to run rough as well. So be sure to check all them sensors down there which run for the DPF. The next one on these that like to fail is the injectors. Now, using cheap fuel, as you'll see, this is a Bosch rail unit. It's the common rail diesel. So you need to be aware of that. When they fail, the injectors sit right here. They're not hard to get to. This is a 2-litre diesel engine, so bear in mind, they're not hard to change. It's one Torx head and that's it. What you've got to be aware of is that when they fail, they're not easy to get out. Sometimes you need a slide hammer just to pull them out. If one of them fails or one of them is not given the right fuel, I'd advise using fuel cleaner. Sometimes that can work, but sometimes it might not. Sometimes you might go and put that in, it might not help your injectors. You might need to buy a new, whole new injector. But if they do fail, they're not hard to change. They sit right up here, but I'd recommend using a slide hammer. You just take the fuel line off and that's it, and then just pull the injector out and there you go, you're on your way. So if you ain't aware of that, make sure you check your injectors, because I get a lot of people with the 2-litre diesel have this issue, misfiring, and it's usually the injectors that are at fault, because they do go and will go using cheap fuel. And I know in a lot of countries you don't get the kind of fuel we get, so your fuel is not that great, and obviously it does cause problems with your injectors. The next one you're going to notice right here is there's no EGR on this car either. Now that's because the person that owned it, which is George, he removed the whole EGR system, which is a very smart move. It's what I recommend on any car doing, to remove the EGR valve, because that clogs up and that will cause you to run rough on power. It also causes your engine to ping. You don't want pinging noise where the valve ain't opening properly, where it's causing the injectors to cause diesel knock. You can call it pinging or diesel knock, whatever one you want to call it. But if the EGR is sticking and it gets gunked up, it will cause diesel knock, and it's something you don't want in this car. You'll see it's blanked off from the exhaust manifold there, which goes for the turbo, which the turbo bolts onto. Do you want to be careful of that? You want to blank it off and remove it completely from here. It looks a lot more tidy, a lot more engine friendly. You can get to the engine if you need to, get to the belts. You also notice that the water pump sits down here. they don't usually like to fail. They're not like the petrols, they don't fail that much, so you don't really have to change them so much, but obviously it's worth changing. If you do blank off your EGR valve, you want to then make sure you clean your map sensor as well, to make sure that the map sensor is running perfectly, which is right here. It's only one 10 mil bolt and it comes straight off. And make sure you clean it out, because what happens is if oil does get into the manifold, it will soak that up as well. The same with the crankcase breather. If that blows and the diaphragm ruptures, that will leak oil back into the crankcase, back into the manifold, and destroy your map sensor, which will cause your rough running codes as well. What happens is these get clogged in soot from the diesel, and basically nobody, your car won't know what to, the manifold absolute pressure of the whole engine, which means it will throw it into limp mode. So be aware of that as well. The next one you're going to want to do is the inlet air temp sensor, which is right here as well on the diesels. They fail. That's a common problem on the M57 as well. This is the inlet temperature sensor for the charge pipe. You need to be careful of that one, because if that one fails as well, that's when you'll lose turbo boost as well, because that inlet temp sensor monitors the pressure coming from the turbo and the air to make sure it's not hot and it's cooled down before it re-enters back in the engine. Because as you know, the turbo air comes from the turbo into the intercooler, cools down and goes back into the engine itself before ready to charge up again. You also see here, this is on a throttle valve as well, which is not like the normal petrol engines. This is on a electronically controlled body, and you cannot take that off from think of removing it. You can clean that out. Sometimes they get gunked up as well, so be aware of that. I've seen them many times on the M57 where these have been gunked up. You need to make sure you put that back on. They are crucial for the car to run, crucial for your flap, crucial for your accelerator. And if they are running like crap, trust me, you will end up feeling it, because these do get dirty and they're not hard. Just one retaining clip, pull the pipe off, and you can spray it while it's on the car itself. Like I say, that isn't the case for all cars. M57, that all sits here. It's called the shutter valve. You need to put it here, make sure the shutter valve, and you need to take everything off to get to it here. But on the 2-litre diesel, you can just pull that clip, take the pipe off, and clean it out yourself. So guys, the next one I'm going to go on to is the fuel lines itself. Make sure your fuel lines are fine, which is the return line right here. You want to make sure they're fine, because obviously they run back onto the fuel pump. Fuel pumps on these, they like to fail as well. It's a common problem on all the diesels. Like I say, diesel, most common cause of that is people running on the reserves all the time. When you run low on the diesel, you've got to remember diesel lubricates all the pumps on the diesel. It's not like a petrol where it doesn't lubricate them. Diesel is designed to lubricate the pumps. The moment you run low, you risk blowing your pumps because they overheat, because they're not lubricated properly. So something you have to be aware of on these cars. The next one on them is turbo failure. It's a common problem. I've seen many cases on these cars with turbo failure. I've actually got one coming to me, which is a 120D on the same year, next week, with a turbo failure. It's whistling. It's a common problem on these, and they do fail. That's usually due to people abusing them, running low on oil, and the next thing is going up a lot of hills where you're straining out the turbo too much. Because what happens is when you overheat the turbo ends up whining, where the turbine comes loose and it starts got play in it in the shaft. So again, that's why it causes the whistling. Another one is a turbo seals going when it's remapped, but it depends on how you get it remapped. I know a lot of people end up getting these cars remapped for power, and I tell a lot of people, do not get these cars remapped for power. If you need power, go for the 530R, go for something more powerful. You know, I tell people a lot of the time, if you need to go for a diesel to get power, seriously, it's the wrong move. Do not go to a diesel to get power. These cars don't really handle well on a remap. The guy that owns it, which is George, he's got it done for eco remap, which is better than power. I believe it's the best way forward. Putting it on a power remap puts all the injectors on the strain. That's why injectors fail, turbos fail, EGR fails. The best thing you can do is put this on an eco map and avoid the power map at all costs. The next thing you guys will see here is the thermostat right here. That's the thermostat housing going to the block itself. Again, not a hard thing to replace, but if your thermostat's on this way out, that will cause your EGR to stick as well, because the EGR that works with the coolant temps as well. So the coolant in the engine's got to be hot before the DPF can regenerate. It uses water to flow through the EGR valve, so be aware of that you have got the thermostat replaced, because the thermostat is crucial for the DPF regeneration as well. A lot of people ain't aware of that if that sticks, that will cause your DPF not to regenerate, because the thermostat has got to be perfect for the car to be regenerated. Everything has to be perfect on the car. The next thing you guys are going to be aware of is the glow plugs as well on this engine. Now, as you guys know, the glow plugs sit right down there, and to get to them, it's not actually hard. It's quite easy, and so does the glow plug module. The glow plug module sits down there as well with the glow plugs. Now, they like to fail all the time. Luckily, this car doesn't have that problem. This car's been very well looked after. But like I say, the majority of people end up without their glow plugs working, and then the problem with that is they try and start their car up in winter, and they realise that their car's not starting because their glow plugs ain't working. They leave it too long and some people just choose to forget it because it's expensive. I don't know whoever told people that diesel's cheap to maintain. It's cheap to maintain on fuel-wise, but not cheap to maintain on parts. And that's because diesel parts last a long time. So shops and sellers find it very hard to sell a diesel part because diesel parts don't fail as often as a petrol. That's why petrol parts are very cheap and diesel parts are very expensive for that reason. The next one you're going to want to do is make sure you check this hose, because I can tell right now from here it's just like a petrol. It's very brittle and it can crack. This hose can crack very easily from here. Now with the EGR being plugged there as well on next to this valve, I wouldn't be surprised from the EGR getting hot on the engine bay that this hose becomes brittle and just snaps the moment you touch it. Now this hose goes back into the intake boot, so you've got to be careful of that, because if this hose is plugged up, it pulls the pressure from the crankcase, as you'll see there, from the crankcase wheel, from the oil down to the air to the intake boot itself. So you've got to be careful of that. So what you've got to be careful of is that it's not heated and it's not cracked, because if this hose is cracked, which you can probably plug up right now, you'll see right there, you'll replace this one, but you'll see here it's all gunked up in there. It goes for the CCV. It's the hose that pulls air to stop the, so the crankcase has got vacuum to pull all the excess oil so it doesn't go back into the intake manifold itself. So you need to be careful to check that. So that's basically it, guys. There's not really many other common problems on this engine as far as I've really listed. Most of them on here are the glow plugs, which are right down there. Like I said to you, the injectors, the turbo, the electronic actuator, also the map sensor, the inlet air temp sensor, the shutter valve, you know, your thermostat, your DPF, your DPF sensors. The majority of these are covered in this video, and there's not many on this car. It's a 2-litre diesel engine. The only one, next one I'm going to explain, the reason I've left this for last, is the timing chain. The timing chain on these are problematic. Now, from 2010, they rectified the issue on these engines. BMW started using the revised part, the longer chain guide, and they started doing it, the engine was a lot more reliable. But all the way up to 2010, the timing chain would snap on these engines. What would happen is the tensioner would snap and the chain would come loose and the engine would just destroy itself. This is something that's got to be addressed on this engine, but I believe already, to be at this mileage is on, I think the timing chain's already been done, and I believe the tension has already been done on this. What happened, BMW revised it with a longer tensioner, a more stable one, but everyone who owns this engine probably is aware that the timing chain snaps on this, and this relates for 116D, 118D, 120D. It doesn't matter what car you've got, it's all the M47 engine. They all suffered a problem with the timing chain failure. They suffer timing chain problems, and your timing chain will snap. It's not a case of when it's going to, it's not a case of if, it's a case of when it's going to snap, and it will snap. It's crucial it's going to snap. You need to get the tensioner changed unless you find out from the previous owner if it hasn't snapped. Like I say, it is a costly job because the timing chain sits on the back of the engine. You need to take the gearbox out to get to it, but once it's done, it's done, and you guys don't have to worry about it. Garages usually charge around a grand, maybe 1,200 just to do it, because it's a big job involved. That's why you've got to be careful if you're going to buy one of these cars, that you make sure all these common problems have been addressed before you buy it. Do not just think of going out and buying a 2-litre diesel without these problems being addressed. The timing chain, all cars are plagued in an issue. If you're looking at one before 2010, trust me, it's going to be plagued an issue with the timing chain tensioner. BMW didn't rectify. You usually check by the build date, and that's when you know when the engine was produced, and then you just when you know if you have got the revised tensioner. But that's all it is to this car, guys. Like I said, just make sure you check all them common problems, the worst one being the timing chain. Make sure there's no rattle from that timing chain area when you go to view it. Usually it'll be rattling where the tensioners broke off and it's flapping the chain in the back of the engine, so be aware of that. And it'll also be down on power, very badly down on power, so just be advised that when you go to look at one, you make sure it's not like that. Okay, guys, so as you've just seen now, I've just gone over the reliability video for the M47 engine. So as you guys have seen, the M47 is quite reliable. It just depends on how you look after it. The timing chain is a massive, massive problem. It's still happening to this day and age. The turbo is another big problem on these. You have to be aware of these things before you go and buy one. If you have bought one, you're going to have to do a timing chain. Any before 2010, the timing chain is coming, and your day is coming where it's going to snap, and it's going to cost you big, big money to be fixed. If you let it go too long, it will just destroy the engine. So be aware that you must get that timing chain problem fixed immediately. Like I say, if you have got any other problems in the timing chain have been fixed, please refer to the video, as your problem will be mentioned in there, and the majority of it is people have missed out, or they haven't checked these things first before they've come to the video, and that's the problem why I'm trying to make you guys aware of how to look after your M47 engine, because obviously I know how they run and what they operate on. It's just the same as the M57 engine, just the M57 did not suffer with a timing chain problem. Only the M57N engine did when it was remapped. It had a problem where when it was remapped, the timing chain would snap. But the N47 engine is a problematic regardless. It's not a, regardless you remap it or not, it's going to break. The tensioner will go, and there is a revised one. Like I said, you need to get it from BMW. Yours might already have it. If you are are looking to purchase one, or go through your service history, go through the papers you got, it might have already been done. If it has been done, it's just saved you a lot of money because it's a massive job. Gearbox has got to be dropped, the back of the timing chain cover's got to come off, and it's all got to be replaced, and it is quite a big pig of a job. So as always, guys, thank you very much for watching this BMW Dr. Dini. I hope you've enjoyed this video. If you have, please give it a thumbs up. If you haven't subscribed already, please go ahead and subscribe. And please remember to subscribe to George's channel as well, as it's George's car we were doing the video with. Thank you very much, guys, and goodbye.